will I fail my drug test? Will CBD show up or create a positive drug test?
Yeah, that's a great question. So, I mean, and it's also a question that I get all the time from patients, as well as actually other practitioners too, because some of them are interested in incorporating CBD into their life to like help to sleep or with mood balance, because of especially like all the stressors that especially that happened in 2020. And so like, I've gotten so many questions. And so, I mean, this is a great topic to talk about. So when we're talking about urine drug tests, overall, the ones that are most popularly used, they detect for what's called tetrahydrocannabinol. So that's THC. Mm-hmm. So CBD itself, if you're using, for example, so the 2018 Farm Bill stated that products that are on the market that you can find, you know, at your drugstore, for example, rather than a dispensary, that those products need to have less than 0.3% THC to be legal. And that has to do with industrial hemp and the way that the market is now. So because it is that way, it really depends on the product that's being consumed. So if you are consuming a CBD isolate product, for example, that means that it's only CBD. And so I would be literally 100%, I would say, if it is a good product, maybe not 100%, that's true, but if it is a good product, they've done their studies and they have the COA accessible, all that good stuff, then I would say a CBD isolate is not something I would be worried about in terms of coming up on a drug test, because CBD and THC are just simply different compounds. Mm-hmm. Whereas if we're talking about broad spectrum, that is CBD plus a lot of the other minor phytocannabinoids, plus terpenes, but does not have THC. So again, I would not be worried about that. Okay. And then when it comes to full spectrum, so full spectrum is broad spectrum. So that's CBD, the other minor phytocannabinoids, terpenes, but then it also has THC, again, only less than 0.3% to be legal. But I mean, so because it is such a small percentage, and if you are using a great company that does the studies and makes them accessible and like the laboratory studies and all of that, I would say that there's a very, very, very low likelihood that anything will appear on a drug test simply from the percentage. And if it is from a good company, but we're not 100% certain, of course, on that. And because there is that 0.3%, it is possible. Mm-hmm. So if someone is worried about, let's say, for example, like when I was in pharmacy school, they did random drug tests. And so I know that like if someone was in pharmacy school or in like a postgraduate doctoral program that has that opportunity to get randomly drug tested, I would not recommend a full spectrum product, because that little percentage could actually show up. It's very low likelihood, but to err on the side of caution, that would be my recommendation. Yeah. But CBD isolate and broad spectrum overall, I'm not worried about it appearing in a drug test.
Okay, awesome. And is there a cutoff limit for the presence of CBD and THC in tests? Like, does this translate into a safe dosage or THC concentrated in full spectrum products that we should look for? Like you were talking mm-hmm. about the isolate and from not being worried, but.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So in terms of, so when we're talking about like a safe dosage or THC percentage concentration, there isn't necessarily a cutoff, but I think, as I said, like if it's present, then it can appear and it is possible regardless of, you know, it might be a very, very, very low likelihood, but it's still possible. Mm-hmm. And I think it comes down to the patient themselves in terms of their endocannabinoid system, because everyone's functions just a little bit differently. And that's not to say that one person like necessarily has a better functionality or an improved functionality or anything. It's just that everyone's functions just a little bit different. And so because it functions just a little bit different, that means that we all metabolize CBD just a little bit differently, as well as metabolize cannabis THC just a little bit differently. And so it's very patient specific. It also could depend on other medications they're on that could influence its metabolism and, mm-hmm. you know, their pharmacokinetics in general. So it really depends. And if someone is worried about getting random drug tested or going through a drug test for a new job or whatever it is, I would just recommend that the patient stay away from full spectrum in general. Then they won't have anything to worry about.
Yeah, that makes absolute sense. So with the CBD products, how long does CBD stay in your body? And should you avoid it before a known test to prevent a positive if you're taking full spectrum?
Yes, absolutely. So in terms of how long it stays in the body, so that has a lot to do with its half-life. And so half-life means just the time for the body to eliminate half of the initial amount consumed. That's generally how it's looked at when we're looking at how long something stays in the body. So when it comes to CBD, orally, it's been shown that it stays in the body for 1 to 2 days, but of course that's not conclusive. And it's, we also don't know with other formulations. A lot of research is actually going on in this realm because there have been some research before, but there hasn't been that many studies in humans when it comes to actual conclusive numbers. Okay. So hopefully next time we chat or in the next few years, you know, they'll actually have those numbers. But, the range right now that people do talk about is 1 to 2 days for orally consumed. Again, when you're asking how long does CBD stay in the body, I mean, if we're talking about a drug test, I'm not necessarily concerned if they're only taking a CBD isolate or broad spectrum product. But it also depends on, let's say they are taking a full spectrum product, and let's say that they do use it every single day to alleviate some of their anxiety and they take it every single morning. It does matter the dosage, but I'm more concerned with the frequency with which they take it. So if they are taking that full spectrum every single day, like clockwork, I am a little more concerned. But that being said, if someone's just trying it here or there, you know, I still wouldn't take it close to the time when they're going to get that drug test, because again, the metabolism can be so different. But overall, I think that it really matters more of the frequency rather than the actual dose. And then on top of that, I would also say it depends on the type of product, as we mentioned before.
Yes, absolutely. And that leads into my next question, which you kind of touched on. Does form matter? Does a tincture versus a topical or inhalable, will they show up differently on tests and are any less likely to show up, which you sort of touched on already?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But I can talk specifically about some, like one of the formulations that I think is like very popular right now, which is the topical formulation. And a lot of topical formulations are full spectrum and they do have that less than 0.3% THC. So for someone who, which is like kind of in contrast to what I just said, but, for in general, like for full spectrum products, when it comes to topical, I'm not as worried simply because the way that they are absorbed by the skin, it really is more of what's called a local absorption. So it really does stay in that area and in that like area of skin in particular, right, to exert that type of effect that we're looking for. So very little gets into the bloodstream, and it really does need to enter the bloodstream to some capacity to show up mm-hmm. on a urine drug screen, or like a blood test, for example. And so when it comes to topical, I'm really not that concerned, which is good for people who are interested in using that for joint pain or muscle aches or anything. But so I think that that's important to bring up. But yes, again, like with form, I'm more concerned with the actual like product itself and how frequently they're taking it. To a point, dose matters, of course. And I mean, there's like the difference between pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics as well. So kinetics is what the body does to the drug. And so that's the way it's absorbed and distributed and then metabolized and then of course eliminated from the body. Mm-hmm. And then dynamics is what the drug does to the body. So when the drug enters the body, what receptors it's working with, and then also like how it goes through the body, where it's present, all of that. And so when it comes to different formulations, the pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics can differ, in particular the pharmacokinetics. But again, we don't know anything as conclusive as like talking about topical users.
Okay, that's really mm-hmm. interesting. And so does the type of drug test matter, whether it's urine, breath, saliva, blood, hair?
So that's when it can get a little more interesting when it comes to formulation. So when we're talking about like inhalation, for example, it depends, of course, the way that the patient inhales, like their technique as well as their lung capacity. But when it's inhaled, it surpasses or bypasses what's called the first pass effect, which has to do with the way that the body would metabolize it using the gastrointestinal tract or like using the like liver metabolism. Mm-hmm. So when you're ingesting something orally, it actually less of it is absorbed because of that first pass effect. Whereas when you're inhaling something, you're bypassing that. And so more of it does go into your bloodstream and more of it does, you know, have that effect more immediately. Mm-hmm. And so with a blood test, I would be more concerned with like someone who had inhalation products that they used with lots of frequency and high doses and all of that. But overall, when it comes to like consuming orally, I mean, at the end of the day, like when cannabis, CBD, THC, like whatever phytocannabinoids there are, it has been shown that they are metabolized by this one enzyme system that's the most highly, like densely concentrated in the liver.
Okay.
And so to a certain extent, yes, like everything before it is eliminated, it will be metabolized to a certain extent by these enzymes. So, I mean, it does matter to a point, but it also doesn't matter the type of drug test because it will be in some form or another, like in the body. It just depends.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, it's, yeah, nothing conclusive.
Are there more common ones than others used?
Yeah, I think urine is the most commonly used in particular for like when I mentioned the random drug tests or like, I think it depends also the type of job. Like I know when people are going for certain types of jobs, like for like a more federal level job, they might do a blood test because that can be a little more accurate and it like can stay in the blood a little longer than something like a urine drug test. So it depends the situation, but I mean, I would definitely, if the patient is considering utilizing a product that does have THC in it, I would make sure that they would look into everything concerning like how their job or intended or desired job deals with the use of drugs and really how that looks.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
This is a good lead into, does it make a difference if my state is legal for recreational and medical with testing, or is it totally dependent on companies or however, whatever you're being tested for?
It very much depends because like I would initially think, right, that it would have something more to do with the state, but the company regulations can overrule the state in some instances, or it could overrule like what is being said federally. And when, I mean, what's being said federally goes back to the farm bill, that less than 0.3% of having products, full spectrum products with THC and the possibility of those showing up in a drug test. So it really depends. And I think like, I don't want to make any like sweeping statements or anything, because I really do think it comes down to where the person is hoping to get a job or is even currently working.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely agree. And do I have to, or should I disclose my consumption usage before a test?
See, that's where it gets a little more interesting, because some patients are on, you know, medically recommended products. Like they're on a cannabis product that they have like a medical card for, and they're utilizing it for a specific use that has either been recommended by, you know, their oncologist or their physician or whomever their provider is. So I think that that could be valid, but I think that that conversation needs to happen way before the test, like not in the instance when they're getting that test at the moment, but that should be something that is a part of the discussion prior to, you know, entering the exam room for getting the test, because those people should know. And I mean, I guess in that context, if a patient is taking it medically, then we are to assume that that state does allow its legal medical use. So yeah, a lot of nuance and a lot of differences when it comes to the like patient themselves, when it comes to the company they want to work for, and then of course also what they're using it for.
Well, thank you so much.
Well, thank you for having me. Yeah. And if anyone has any questions or anything, please go to my website and fill out the message board there, or you're more than welcome to email me as well. You can put all the information in the notes, but it's drswathi.com. So D-O-C-T-O-R. So doctor spelled out. And then my name, S-W-A-T-H-I, but that'll all be in the notes. So if you have any follow-up questions, I know that a lot of stuff when it comes to CBD and THC and all these other, you know, cannabis related acronyms get very complicated.